This is a lattice, and so is this. It's a bunch of points or dots in a repeating pattern. And while these pictures look pretty simple, they're the setup for some seriously hard math problems. Normally, that might be kind of a bummer, but in this case, it's a good thing. Because lattice problems are hard to solve, they could be the basis for the post-quantum future of cryptography. Here's a rapid summary of the last video. A future quantum computer could break a lot of modern cryptography, throwing a massive wrench into the world's secure communication infrastructure. Post-quantum cryptography is designed to defend against this. It's about creating cryptographic algorithms which are secure against attacks from a quantum computer. Many of the most promising algorithms are lattice-based, meaning they have something to do with these kinds of pictures. More precisely, this two-dimensional lattice is generated, or created, by these two vectors, or arrows. We start with a dot at the origin and dots at the end of each basis vector. From there, we build. We lay down the vectors like dominoes to form paths, starting from the origin. And the lattice is made up of all of the points that we can reach with these vector snakes. For example, this point is 2 times the red vector plus 1 times the blue vector. The vectors can be flipped around, and we can stack any number of them together. We could describe this point as -1 red plus -2 blue plus 1 red, but we can lump the reds together and then they'll cross each other out. So it's really just -2 blue. The blue and the red vectors are a basis for this lattice. They're used to build all the points. As the basis vectors move, so do the lattice points. Let's look at this on the usual two-dimensional plane. Say that our basis vectors are 1, 0 in red, 1 in the x direction and 0 in the y direction, and 0, 1 in blue. These make the normal square lattice. But zooming out, what if we use these two basis vectors, 7, 3 and 2, 1? The coordinates of our basis vectors will always be whole numbers. Let's start by constructing some lattice points by putting dots at the ends of the vectors. We can add 2 blue vectors or just 1 negative red vector, or 1 negative blue vector. At first, they look to be creating points on a line, but if we start stacking together positive and negative vectors, we get other points, and eventually, you'll end up with the same square lattice. This illustrates an important point. Two very different looking sets of basis vectors can generate the same lattice. That lattice was pretty easy to describe. It's all the points with integer or whole number coordinates. But in general, it's not so easy to do that, to describe all the points on a lattice, except to say it's the lattice generated by these vectors. For example, here are two other basis vectors, 2913 and 7638. What does the lattice generated by these vectors look like? We can start to fill in some points, starting with the 2 points at the ends of the basis vectors. We can add them together to get 10551, or take red minus blue to get -47, -25. We can start building up individual points, but the full picture isn't necessarily obvious. Here's a surprisingly hard question. Which point on the lattice is closest to the origin, 0, 0, not including the lattice point that is at the origin? Here's another way to think about it. Which combination of the vectors is closest to 0, 0? For example, 3 reds minus 1 blue vector gives us 11, 1. That's pretty close, but can we do better? Yes. For example, 8 red minus 3 blue vectors is 4, -10, which is slightly closer to the origin. This problem, find the lattice point which is closest to but not equal to the origin, is called the shortest vector problem. Our method, trying different combinations that seemed good, was pretty inefficient. It's possible that the optimal solution comes from adding together many red and blue vectors. In 2 dimensions, you could probably reason your way to a solution. But the shortest vector problem gets very hard in higher dimensions. We used 2 basis vectors with 2 coordinates to create a 2-dimensional lattice. But if we had used 3 basis vectors with 3 coordinates, we would get a 3-dimensional lattice. And 17 basis vectors gives you a 17-dimensional lattice. There's more possibilities in higher dimensions, and the shortest vector problem is even harder. The shortest vector problem is similar to the closest vector problem. Find the lattice point which is closest to a particular point in space. For example, which point on the lattice generated by the two vectors from before is closest to negative 20, 31? These belong to a collection of related problems known as lattice problems, which experts believe to be hard problems, especially in hundreds of dimensions. In other words, it would generally take a computer a very long time to solve the shortest or closest vector problems. And, importantly for our purposes, computer scientists also believe that it would be very difficult for a quantum computer to solve these problems. That makes them good candidates for the mathematical basis for a quantum secure cryptographic protocol. How would that work? Well, here's one idea. Let's say Bob wants to send Alice a message. First, Alice sets up a lattice with two different bases. In other words, both bases generate the same lattice. In one basis, the vectors are close to perpendicular. We're going to call that a good basis. In the other basis, the vectors are much closer to parallel. We're going to call that a bad basis. Here's a fact. The closest vector problem is much harder to solve with a bad basis than a good basis. If you know a good basis for the lattice, it can be somewhat easy to find the closest lattice point. But if you only know a bad basis for the same lattice, it can be much harder to solve the same problem. The bad basis vectors are almost in a line. They can nearly cancel each other out. So the closest lattice point may come from adding and subtracting many, many vectors. So Alice keeps the good basis a secret, that's private information, but she tells Bob and anyone else who might be eavesdropping the bad basis. Now, Bob uses that basis and embeds a message in the lattice. He picks a point on the lattice, the yellow one, which somehow represents his message. For example, the yellow point is 0 times the first red vector and 2 times the second blue vector. That would represent the secret message 02. And then he wiggles away from that point a little bit to create the green point. Now he sends Alice the coordinates of the green point. Alice knows the secret good basis, and she can use that to find the closest lattice point, the yellow one, and recover the message. But an eavesdropper needs to find the closest lattice point using only the bad basis. That's the only information they have. But that's the closest vector problem. It's very, very hard. This is the idea behind the GGH encryption scheme. Unfortunately, it isn't secure. There's a sneaky way to simplify the math problem and uncover the secret message, so it's not really a secret. But hope is not lost. Lattices serve as the basis for many promising quantum-resistant cryptographic schemes. In fact, 3 of the algorithms selected for standardization, Kyber, Dilithium, and Falcon, are lattice-based. One common way to build lattice-based cryptography is with something known as the learning with errors problem. And that is the subject of our next video. This video is sponsored by Wire, secure messaging, file sharing, and video conferences, all protected with end-to-end encryption. Go to wire.com, wire.com, for more information.